Hey everyone, welcome back to my YouTube channel. I hope you're having a beautiful day and thanks so much for joining me for another art video. In today's video, I'm going to be walking you through, firstly, my preliminary sketching process for this little white daisy, and then I'm going to go ahead and explain how I painted it using watercolor. This little piece brings forth the opportunity to practice various watercolor techniques that are super awesome, very helpful. They create very nice visual effects. To begin, we're going to be practicing the wet on wet technique. So we're going to be pre-wetting that background with clean water before dropping in our color, which is an awesome practice for beginners just getting started. I often see beginners struggling with that technique. We're going to be doing negative painting in order to save those white petals. And we're also going to be practicing the splattering technique using clean water to develop a bit of texture in that background. All right, so with all that out of the way, let's go ahead and jump straight into it. So to begin, I'm going to be sharing my preliminary sketching process. As I mentioned before, I am using my HB drawing pencil very lightly right on my watercolor sheet. This is a piece of Canson's Heritage 100% cotton, 140-pound watercolor paper. It is cold press, and I actually cut it to be 6.5 inches in height and 6 inches in width. So it's quite small, this little study, which is pretty awesome sometimes to work this small if you're working on little studies or explorations, or even thumbnails for larger pieces that you're going to be working on. Because, you know, if something doesn't turn out the way you wanted it to, you can just use the other half of your sheet of watercolor paper. And the smaller it is, the more likely it is that you're going to finish it faster. So it's not going to be that big of a deal if you have to redo it, which I redo pieces all the time. All right, so what you're seeing me work on right now, and I'm sorry if it looks pretty light, this is the lightness that I actually use when it comes to creating my preliminary sketches on my watercolor paper, because I don't like my pencil showing through my translucent paint at the end. And I'm also doing my best not to scratch or damage my watercolor paper, because there is no taking that back. And also, because I am doing this freehand, I know that I'm going to be able to erase mistakes a lot more easily the lighter I draw. The way that I like starting most of my freehand flower sketches is I lay down what I like referring to as envelopes. So I imagine the entire petal area being surrounded by just a line connecting the longest petals just from tip to tip, or a big blocky, more geometric shape. Because that way I am able to better replicate. I'm not really going for full perfection here, especially when it comes to more organic, natural subjects like flowers, but there is a greater chance that I am going to arrive at better proportions and that overall shape if I focus on the general picture and make my way towards specifics. I never get started with the smaller parts or with each individual petal or anything like that. I focus on the largest general areas first and make my way towards smaller details only after I have visualized that and have arrived at relatively effective proportions. This method also helps me utilize my drawing space a lot more effectively, as opposed to working on drawing from one side of the subject to the other side of the subject, or something like that, which often leads to the drawing being way off center or way off to the side, or even like end up not fitting in your drawing space. By seeing the general picture first and placing it where you actually want it, it just leads to a better use of your space. So after that initial envelope for that largest overall general petal area has been laid out, then I go ahead and add in the second largest shape, which in this case is that central part of this flower. And I compare the central shape to the largest shape in terms of its size, its location, the little angles I see that are being created. Because getting proportions right is all about getting those relationships between the different parts of the whole correct. And so this is the point at which I'm constantly starting to compare the different elements to each other. And the more elements you start adding in, the more points of comparison you're gonna have. So you're constantly comparing different parts in terms of their length, their width, their location within space, the different angles that they create upon each other, etc. And that's how I arrive at effective proportions. Once I was happy with those two shapes, the larger one and the smaller one inside, or those envelopes, I started adding in the individual petals. Now, different types of flowers are very different in terms of the shape of their petals, the amount of petals that they have, how those petals are overlapping, etc. And for different types of flowers, I may approach the drawing of those petals in a different way. Sometimes when I am drawing roses, for example, I like starting with the outer petals, which in roses, because roses create this closed up kind of bulb-like form, it makes sense for me to start with the outer petals because we're able to see more of them. So those are larger shapes, and I make my way towards the inner petals, which are mostly covered by the exterior petals. For this one, this flower has quite a bit of petals, but it's more of an open kind of face flower, so to speak. And so what I'm trying to get at is you really have to think of what is going to facilitate the process for you in terms of creating that preliminary sketch effectively, depending on the subject on hand. For this one, sometimes it makes sense to jump around and not necessarily go either clockwise or counterclockwise, but jump around, drawing different little groups of petals, and then adding the petals in between after you visualized lengths and how different petals are going to be grouping together and how other petals are going to be overlapping, etc. It's super, super important to break away from creating any sort of organized pattern or perfect looking shapes, and to incorporate, to actually make mindful use of irregularity and imperfection when we're drawing or painting natural subjects such as flowers. So I really kept on observing that reference photo right there on the left as I was drawing all of these petals, noticing these different clumps, how certain petals stick out more than others or look longer to me, how they are curving out or off in different ways. It's super important to pay attention to these things. And you don't have to necessarily bring in every single petal that you see in the photo. You can take some out. There's really not much of an issue. It's still gonna look like a flower. But when it comes to drawing something like a portrait or an animal or something that is actually man-made, so think of still life arrangements with like vases of flowers or books or something like that, it's a lot more important to spend a good amount of time on that outline sketch because proportions have to be way more precise. It's easier to tell when proportions are off or when perspective is off and stuff like that when we are drawing or painting something that is man-made, that has a lot more symmetry oftentimes to it, or a lot more perfection in terms of those 3D geometric forms. All right, so once I was done with adding in the petals, it was time to move on to the secondary and tertiary little elements in this little piece, which are the stem and the leaves. So as you can see, I use my artistic license. I actually brought in a couple of leaves. These are things that don't really show in that reference photo, but I think that it's important to sometimes make artistic choices in terms of what I feel is going to add to this visual composition, make it look better, or more interesting. And finally, something I often like doing before getting started with the painting process is using my kneaded eraser to gently tap over my preliminary sketch to get rid of any excess graphite or even lighten my sketch a little bit more. All right, so moving on to the painting process. And as always, I want to share these specific colors that I am going to be using, though you by no means have to use these exact same colors. Use what you have that is similar and you'll be fine. These are all colors from my St. Petersburg White Nights full pan paint set that I bought via Amazon. I'm going to be using Indian Yellow, Raw Sienna, Burnt Umber, Sap Green, a black that is particular to the St. Petersburg watercolor line, I think, and Indigo. All right, so the very first color mixtures that I want to prepare for myself are for my background. So we're going to be painting in the background wet on wet. We are going to be pre-wetting the entire background with clean water and dropping in our color on that water. So I want to make sure that I have all of my color mixtures already prepared because it would make no sense for me to pre-wet my paper and then make my color mixtures because then the paper is going to start drying and I'm probably not going to be able to create the effects that I want to create. So it's important that when you're working wet on wet, you have your color mixtures all ready for you on your color mixing palette. And you kind of know what it is that you're gonna be doing with those colors. All right, so I prepared three different greens for myself, and you could consider these a light green, a medium green, and a dark green. The lighter green was created by mixing together my Indian yellow and my sap green. The medium green is just plain sap green with some water in it. And the dark green is sap green plus a bit of indigo. Now, just a moment ago, you saw me test out these color mixtures on a scrap piece of watercolor paper. I always have scrap pieces of watercolor paper on hand whenever I am painting with this medium to test out my colors and my translucencies before actually using them in my painting. But I recommend testing out your greens so that you can make sure that there is a good difference between your three greens. Otherwise, there is not going to be that noticeable of a variety of greens in your background. All right, so another thing that is important to make sure you do is that you have to make sure that your color mixtures are juicy, they have a good amount of water in there, but also a good amount of color in there, because we're gonna be dropping in this paint into paper that has been pre-wetted. So there's already going to be an amount of water on your paper when you drop in your color. If your color mixtures are super, super watery and very, very translucent on your color mixing palette, then that color is gonna look probably even lighter because that color is gonna be distributed amongst and diluted in some amount of water content that is already on your paper. And you wanna make sure that there is, you know, a good amount of color in that background and that we don't have to go in with a second layer of color to deepen and darken and make certain colors look more vibrant. So I would say look for a 50% color, 50% water ratio, something along those lines in your color mixtures whenever you're going to be dropping your paint onto paper that has been pre-wetted if you want a good amount of color in there. All right, so after having prepared all of my different greens, I removed all of the color from my paintbrush bristles. This is my size 16 round brush and I'm going to continue using it as I paint in my background. I am taking a bit of water at a time from my container and I am really taking my time pre-wetting everything except for the flower. Now, if you're more comfortable switching to a smaller brush in order to get into the little tiny nooks and crannies and little corners and angles in between those petals, then by all means go ahead and switch to a smaller brush. But I would highly recommend using a larger or at least a medium-sized brush, because otherwise if you use a very small brush to do your pre-wetting, your paper is going to start to dry because obviously the smaller the brush, the less amount of water you're bringing out from your container to do your pre-wetting, and you have to go back and forth and it's just going to take way longer and things are going to start to dry. Really take your time. You want to make sure that you go over everything, I would say at least 3 to 4 times, and it's really going to vary depending on the environment, the situation that you're working in. If you're working in a very warm environment or a cold environment, or you have a fan on or the air conditioning on, all of those things are going to have a great impact on how fast your paper dries. And you want to make sure that when you drop in your color, there is a good amount of moisture and wetness on your paper. Otherwise, that paint is not going to expand outwards and merge together into the other colors, which is what we're looking for. So take your time pre-wetting your paper until you arrive at a nice, even, uniform sheen all throughout. You want to make sure that you're doing it lightly though, because you don't want to start affecting your paper by going over one same area too aggressively. But do make sure that you're going over everything at least a few times gently. After I arrived at a nice even sheen, it was time to start dropping in my green color mixtures. And I started out by placing the lightest green first, and at this point I'm already starting to place the medium green. And in just a bit, you're gonna see me start also placing the darkest green. For the background especially, I am just working in an intuitive manner. I don't have any specific pattern or placement or anything like that that I was specifically planning for my different greens. I am just loosely dropping in that color and enjoying the, you know, the effects that are organically happening as I drop in that color on paper that has been pre-wetted. Aside from working from lighter green and making my way towards darker green, and then maybe going back and forth after that, I am just continuing to drop in my color and sometimes going in with just a damp paintbrush and lightly moving that color around that's already placed on my paper until I arrive at something that looks nice to me, until I've arrived at a nice variety of different greens throughout this area. And yeah, I'm just continuing to play and explore with that color. Now, something I will say though is that it's important to just stop yourself from going over your paper with your paintbrush over and over and over again, because you're gonna start flattening out areas and you can even start overworking or damaging your paper. So embrace those organic effects that happen when you just drop in that color on your pre-wetted paper and focus more on arriving on a nice variety of different greens throughout your background. Try your best to leave that paint be. You know, you can go in to do some gentle, minimal moving around of that color after it's been placed. But the more you go in and move that paint around, it's more likely that you're gonna flatten things out. So just go in very gently if you wanna move anything around and then leave it be. All right, so I'm almost done with my background here. You can see how I have a nice variety of greens. I have some sections that look very light, others that look like a nice mid-tone, and others that look darker. I'm now going to allow that paint to settle on that paper just for a tiny bit before starting to do my splattering on my background using clean water. Now, in the meantime, I'm gonna go ahead and change my water because it's pretty green at this point, and I have to make sure that the water is nice and clean so that I can do my splattering. For the splattering technique that we're gonna be using next, your paint still has to be wet, so make sure that you're working relatively fast. Okay, so moving on to the splattering. This is super fun. You definitely don't want to go overboard. A little bit goes a long way. I am using clean water and my size 6 round brush. And while those greens in my background are still wet, what I am doing is I am loading up a little bit of water in my paintbrush bristles, removing the excess water because I don't want to be dripping water all over the place. But I need a bit of water in those bristles, and then I am flicking those bristles using my index finger so that I have some drops of water just splattering on that paint that is still wet. And you can see this beautiful texture that gets created. What happens is that all of these little drops of water that are getting splattered onto that wet paint are disturbing that paint that is kind of midway through that drying process. It's disturbing that paint and it's creating all of these little teeny tiny blooms in slightly different sizes, and this creates a nice looking texture. After having painted in that background, which is a negative painting technique because we're painting around the actual subject, it was time to allow that to dry, and I jumped on over to working on the first layer of paint in the central part of this flower. Because since the background is still a little bit wet, I cannot really start painting in the stem or the leaves or even the petals, because if I start painting them in, then that green from the background is gonna seep into this new area of wetness, because watercolor is always going to expand into paper that is wet. So what I am doing right here is, once again, I created a nice variety of different colors for this area of my flower so that I could create a nice little sense of dimension in the central part of the flower. I always like working from light and more translucent color towards more dark and saturated color, meaning I go in initially with the lightest color of the group, And I make my way towards the darker color, but I also almost always start with my color mixtures in a more translucent, watered-down state. And I make my way towards drier, more saturated color mixtures, meaning color mixtures that have a less amount of water in them, as I move forward and make my way into darker values. Using my size 5 round brush, I went in with the lightest color of the bunch, which I created by mixing together some raw sienna plus my Indian yellow. That's the lightest color that you see there in that central part of that flower. And while it's still wet, I am dropping in the medium color that I chose for this area, which is pure burnt umber plus a little bit of water in it. And you can see how I am using kind of a scribbling technique. I'm doing an up and down motion, but also moving my paintbrush from side to side in loops and irregular ways. That's me just doing a little bit of lifting of that wet paint because I'm starting to notice that I am depositing way too much of this darker brown in areas that I want to keep lighter. So you can always go ahead and do some lifting with a clean and slightly damp paintbrush and use it as a little absorbent sponge, and you can also use your absorbent towel to lift up some of that paint that is still wet as well if you feel that you're starting to flatten things out. But anyway, there I am starting to describe a little bit of that texture of the central part of this flower by using those up and down motions, just using just the tip of my paintbrush, touching that to the surface of the paper, sometimes doing little loops this way and that, and moving it in very irregular ways in order to start developing that texture. With my second color, my intention wasn't really to just cover up all of that previous lighter golden brownish color that I already developed, but to just darken certain areas within that. I focused on depositing that kind of medium brown that I use for this area mostly along the outer edges of the central part and certain sections along that edge, and also in the most central area. And right here I am dropping in my darkest brown that I was using for this area, which is a combo of my burnt umber plus a tiny bit of indigo. You get a very dark, rich brown. And right here, I am depositing an even less amount of this darkest brown and just focusing on placing it in the centralmost area and in some sections along the edges. That is going to create a raised look for that central part. The darker and darker I get, the less amount of space I want to cover with that darkest color, and I want to allow those previous layers to shine through so that I'm actually able to create a sense of dimension in that area. All right, so after having worked in that central part of the flower, I allowed everything to dry completely. And just a moment ago, you saw me working on this new color mixture, this very dark kind of gray that has a little bit of blue in it. So this is my black, and I mixed a little bit of that indigo into that black just to give it a little bit of a slightly cooler temperature or a slightly bluish look. This particular black that I am using today is a little bit on the warmer side. Whenever I use any sort of ready-made black, whether it's Mars black, ivory black, lamp black, or any of those, I always mix in a color into it because blacks, ready-made blacks like that, they tend to be very dull and very neutral, and they kind of lead to a flat look. It's very easy to create your very dark grays by just mixing other colors together and avoid using ready-made blacks entirely, and I'm gonna make sure to leave a couple of links to blog posts and videos in which I explain why I avoid using ready-made blacks and a few different color combinations that you can start exploring to create your own dark, rich, vibrant color mixtures instead of always reaching out for the ready-made blacks. But when you do use a ready-made black, just try to incorporate another color into it to give it a little bit more of that vibrant look and give it a certain color temperature. You want to make sure that you go in initially with this gray or bluish gray in a very, very watered down, translucent state. You can see me right there, constantly test my color mixture on my scrap piece of watercolor paper before going into my painting with it. And this is especially important because we're painting a white object right now. And what happens when we're painting white objects or even white dogs or white cats is that we really have to make use of that whiteness of the paper to create that white and to create those very light values. If we go in mindlessly and start covering everything up, even when the color is super, super light and translucent, that object or that subject, the fur or whatever it is that you're painting, might not end up looking white. It's going to end up looking gray or whatever other color it is that you're using to develop your different values. So you want to make sure that you're moving along this process mindfully, holding yourself back from just depositing more and more color when it's not really necessary. And that you're always making sure that you're just staying loose and light-handed and are actually incorporating large sections of that white paper as part of the painting. You want to leave lots of paper uncovered. So how do you do it? How do you create a sense of dimension, a sense of little cast shadows in between these petals, etc., but at the same time, leave enough paper uncovered so that this object ends up looking white? So it's very important that you make time to observe your reference photo and notice sections that have darker values in them or mid-tone grays and sections of cast shadows in between your petals. Notice all of that. And that's where you're going to be placing your paint. And at the same time, you want to develop your values again, incrementally, making sure that you're getting started with very, very light, translucent, watered down gray, and then make your way towards darker values. So the way that I decided to get started with painting in the petals was, again, I went in wet on wet. I pre-wetted the entire petal area with clean water, and then started dropping in the watered down gray in the areas of dark values that I was able to see in my reference photo. I was constantly testing out the translucency of my color on my scrap piece of watercolor paper along the way to ensure that I was really getting started with this color in a very, very light translucent state. I made sure to leave several of those petals completely unpainted, especially those petals that I see as being lightest in that reference photo. With that layer of very light gray in there while it was still wet, I allowed myself to drop in even more of this gray, and this time it can be a little bit more saturated than the first. But just by you overlapping two layers of gray, that little area is going to end up looking darker. So with the second layer of gray, I only wanted to darken certain areas within those grays, and I had to make sure that I was constantly observing the reference photo and noticing areas of darkest gray values. So when you were placing that initial very light translucent gray, you can be a little bit more loose and actually apply that lighter gray amongst a wider area, all of the lighter midtones, right? Except for the areas of lightest lights and those petals that are almost completely white. That's okay because that gray is super light and translucent, but the darker you get with your grays, the more intentional you wanna be about placing that darker gray or overlapping that gray, which is gonna make that section look darker, only in darkest value areas. So you have to constantly observe that reference photo. All right, so with that work in the petal area done, it was time to allow that to dry, and I started working on the stem and the leaves. The color mixers that I used to paint in the stem and the leaves were exactly the same color mixers that I used to paint in the background. I just made a little bit more of each using my Indian yellow, my sap green, and my indigo. So again, the point of creating these different colors or these different green variations, a lighter green, a medium green, and a darker green are, so that we're able to develop a little bit of dimension and a little bit of a 3D look in the stem and the leaves. I used my size 5 round brush to pre-wet the leaves and the stem with clean water before dropping in my color, which again, I started by dropping in the lighter color of the bunch. I moved on to the medium green, and I finished up by dropping in my darkest green. When it was time to add in these very thin, smaller little stems, connecting the base stem to the leaves, I switched on over to using my size 1 round brush. And this is my darkest green, the one that has a little bit of that indigo in it. And I did my best to just connect the stem to each leaf with one consistent, smooth stroke. You want to make sure that you're using just the tip of your paintbrush as you're painting that in, so that that line is super thin. And if you are nervous about it, you can always try painting in those lines on a scrap piece of watercolor paper before actually adding them into your painting. Because I added in the leaves from imagination and they're not actually shown in that reference photo, I brought in my knowledge of the leaves that I've seen of this type in my life, and also my knowledge of light behavior as I was developing those different green values throughout the leaves and also in the stem. All right, so we're in the very final stretch of this painting process. If you've made it to this point, congratulations. That is not easy to do. So we are now going to be working wet on dry. So we're going to be painting on dry paper now. This petal area and everything else in the painting is completely dry. And my water has been changed. You can see that it's nice and clean right there to my left. And what I am doing right here is I am using my size 4 round brush. And my objective with this very final part of this painting process is just to push final darkest dark areas, because watercolor always tends to dry lighter than how it looks when it's wet. So whenever it is that we're going for mid to higher levels of realism, it's often helpful to come back to our piece after everything has dried and just evaluate whether another layer is going to be necessary to darken just little areas that need to be pushed a little bit more. Now, if any of the areas that I work on next are dark enough for you, or you don't want to do any more work in these areas, then by all means, just leave them be the way they are. All right, so I go ahead and get started with the petals. So I am going in with the same gray that I had previously prepared for myself with my size 4 round brush. And I make sure initially to go in with this gray in a semi-translucent state. I'm just taking into account the previous values that I've already developed with my gray in the petals. And I kind of think of taking that next step. That next incremental step with the gray, I am not going in super dark and saturated right off the bat, because anything that looks too stark looking is gonna just create a discrepancy, and I just like taking it a step at a time. So you can think of using that previous value that you've already developed throughout this area, but now going in on dry paper. Continue using your scrap piece of watercolor paper to test out your color translucency. And if you go in accidentally with way too dark of a gray or way too much paint, don't worry. Just go in and do some lifting with either the bristles of your paintbrush, using it as an absorbent sponge, or with your absorbent towel and allow it to dry. Or you can also soften dark gray shapes by going in with a clean and slightly damp paintbrush and just distributing that paint amongst a wider area. If you're not covering up highlights, of course, you don't want to cover up highlights, but you can always go in and soften shapes or soften edges with a clean and slightly damp paintbrush. And what I am doing here is I am just focusing on creating a separation between the petals by focusing on areas of cast shadow between the petals, and everything that I'm able to see in the reference photo that needs to get pushed a little bit more, because this is going to help separate those petals apart, right? Because right now they look like they are blobbed together, and I need to separate them and raise them a little bit more. But yes, initially you want to go in with your gray in a pretty translucent state. And then once you have that light gray in, you can allow yourself to go in with the next value, the next step. One key thing that I always make sure to have in mind, especially when I'm working on carving out those darkest darks, is I like staying away from the look of any sort of outline, because outlines are going to retract from the level of realism that I'm trying to develop. It's going to flatten things out. And in real life, there are no outlines around different elements or different parts of objects. It's values that visually separate one part of the object from the other part of the object. So focus on the development of different value shapes that you see in the reference photo. And another thing is that I always make sure that I am acknowledging different value shapes as irregular abstract shapes. Sometimes I like forgetting the fact that I am painting, in this case, a flower, and I just like acknowledging those different value shapes as abstract irregular shapes. One last thing is that I'm constantly reminding myself that less is more and that I don't need to overly describe anything. It's good to constantly take breaks, take a step back from your work, just acknowledge it, just see it as a whole, and really ask yourself if you actually need to push those dark value areas more or add more gray. Take breaks every few minutes, see everything as a whole, and continue asking yourself if you really need to add more paint or if that's just already enough. Once I was happy with my value development throughout those petals, I allowed everything to dry and I started working on darkening darkest value areas in the central part of the flower and in the stem. So for the central part of the flower, I actually decided to go in and do some pre-wetting very quickly with clean water before applying more of the darkest brown that I created by mixing together burnt umber and a little bit of indigo, so that that paint would just soften into that wetness and I wouldn't be creating any sharp edges. After working on that layer of brown wet on wet, I jumped back to working on the stem and I just really darkened certain sections of green right under the petal area where that cast shadow would be created because the petals are blocking that light from hitting this part of the stem. And then I jumped on back to working on darkening certain sections of brown in that central part of the flower, and that is what you're seeing me work on right now. Of course, if your central part of the flower does not look this dark yet, then I would recommend starting out with the medium brown, so the pure burnt umber, and then go over the burnt umber only to darken certain sections with the darkest brown. So it depends on how your painting is looking. Or maybe you already have enough dark values created and you don't even have to do this step at all. This is the final little thing that I am doing here. I went back to using my 1-inch flat brush and I am just going in with a very light gray wash. This is that gray in a very translucent, watered down state. My previous work with my grays is completely dry, so I'm not moving anything around. And I'm just going in very gently. The purpose of this last wash of color is just to darken certain areas. So when you see that reference photo, you get a pretty good idea that these petals on the left have more of a shadow because they are kind of angled in a way that most of the petal or this front face of the petal is away from the light. And the petals kind of in the center opposite to us as the viewer, as well as on the right, are catching most of the light. So this last light wash of gray is just to further darken larger portions of the groups that are kind of standing against the light. If there are larger portions of some of these petals that are being overlapped by others, which you also see as being darker gray midtones, you can also very loosely go over them as well. But do remember that less is more, and you never, never, never want to cover up the areas of lighter midtones and, less of all, the lightest lights. And with that, we are done with this watercolor tutorial.
All right, you guys, that is gonna do it for today's video. I really hope that you found some helpful nuggets in it, that you found it inspiring, and if you did, pretty please, I'd super appreciate it if you give this video a thumbs up and share with family or friends who you think would find it helpful as well. That really helps support the work that I am doing here on YouTube and allows others to get to know about my channel. Thank you so much for watching today. Don't forget to subscribe so that I can see you next week for another video, and keep on creating. Bye guys!